From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Good afternoon. Welcome to the 15th Annual National Book Festival. I hope nobody wishes me to break a leg today. Isn't this a wonderful day to celebrate books? Books are alive and well. My name is Tim Smith. I work for Book World at the Washington Post, and the Post has been a charter sponsor of the National Book Festival since its inception. Michael Buckley is the author of two popular series for young adults. The Sisters Grimm series is about two sisters who are descendants of the Brothers Grimm. They live in a town of fairy tale characters. Sleeping Beauty runs a coffee shop. Snow White is a teacher. Through 9 books, the sisters investigate a myriad of mysteries that will hopefully set aright their fairy tale world. Buckley is also the author of the Nerds series, about a group of outcast fifth graders who run a spy network headquartered in their school. Through the 5 books in the series, they save the president's daughter, confront an evil cheerleader, and cope with a virus that turns people into criminal masterminds. He is also the creator of Robotomy on the Cartoon Network. His latest book is Undertow, about a 16-year-old girl named Lyric Walker from Coney Island, whose community is invaded by a race of water people known as the Alphas. Her hometown becomes a war zone, almost. When Lyric falls for the Alpha's crown prince, she finds they may not be the enemy after all, and a much more sinister fate awaits humanity. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Michael Buckley.
Let's give a round of applause to Tim, who I'm glad he got that second introduction correct so we didn't have to go through that unnecessary ugliness again. Guys, thank you so much. First of all, I want to thank you for coming out to the National Book Festival. I don't know if you've ever been to other book festivals, but they stink. This is the best one ever. This is actually, I think, my 7th time here, so I'm very, very happy to be back. I also want to thank my publisher, Houghton Mifflin Harcourt, for paying the bills. So, when they asked me to speak, they told me that I should talk to you a little bit about where my ideas come from. So I went and watched a bunch of other authors to find out where their ideas come from. Because for me, the answer isn't so glamorous. The truth is, like, for me, the ideas are everywhere. And I hate to say this, but a lot of them I get in the bathroom. I actually have this little thing called ADD. You may have heard of it. And ADD makes my brain work, I think, a little bit differently than most people. I get a lot of ideas all the time. And I'm oftentimes very distracted. Like, she is totally distracting me. This is making me crazy. Hi. Nah, I just made her life hard. I once read a comic book by a guy named Neil Gaiman. Anybody ever heard of Neil Gaiman? Yes, he's the man. He wrote this comic book called Sandman, which was a horror comic. And in one of the stories, a man captured a muse, which is one of the mythological creatures that are supposed to give you ideas and inspirations. And he locked her up in a box and demanded that she give him ideas. And as revenge, the woman gave him zillions of ideas. Ideas that never stopped coming until it actually made him insane. Sometimes I feel like that guy. My ideas come fast and furious. They're there all the time. And when people ask me, where do you get your ideas? I'm always bewildered by that question. Because to me, they seem like they're everywhere. And they seem to hang from trees like fruit. And all I have to do is reach up and grab one. I mean, this morning I had an idea to do a picture book about the missing sock. who goes looking, you know, like the other sock goes looking for the missing sock. And to me, that was just like, oh yeah, mainly because I forgot to pack socks for this trip. But an idea is really just the beginning of a story. It's only really the half of it. It's the candy sweetness of the story. It's the cream filling, the idea of a story. Because there's actually another layer of story that's really the more important part. See, I oftentimes think of what my job is to be sort of a professional liar. Like, I make things up. I make people up, and I make places up, and I make experiences up. And my job is to convince you that they're real, long enough for you to finish the book. And I think that the best writers are the ones who do a really good job at that, but I think the really hidden layer that's super important is what it all means. Like, for instance, Harry Potter is like a really fun story, but it would be terrible if it really wasn't about a mother's love for a child. The best stories have to have some kind of meat in them. And if they're not, really it's just cream filling. So I wanted to tell you a little bit about the meaning of the book I'm writing right now called Undertow. Now, critically, people have said this is brilliant, genius, a game changer, and some of these people were not my mom, but most of them were. Like Tim told you, it's a story of Lyric Walker, who lives in Coney Island. Lyric witnesses the arrival of the Alpha, which is about 30,000 people. Who I guess you could describe as mermaids. Unfortunately, they're not cute like the Little Mermaid. In fact, most of them are kind of grotesque and horrible. And they build a tent city on the beach in Coney Island and they stay, which is basically when the story starts. Now, the idea came to me in a dream. Oh, people who live in the ocean who come to live with us. But like I said, every story has to have some kind of meat. And the meat of this book is really about something that's happening right now in the newspapers during the presidential debates. And it's about racism and immigration and xenophobia. The basis of the story isn't so much about cute mermaids who walk out of the ocean to live with us. It's more about, how would America deal with a brand new minority group? Like, one that wasn't even supposed to exist. Would we handle that? Would we be good at that? I don't think we would. We kind of suck at it. I live in New York City and we have this statue there called Liberty. There's a plaque on it that says, "Give us your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to be free." Sometimes I sit and wonder, people actually take that seriously. I'm not sure that plaque should be on that statue. I think we need to take that off. It's sort of like false advertising. And that's really what this book is about. It's about a brand new group of people coming to the United States to live with us and how we deal with it. A lot of the events in the book are reminiscent of things that your parents might have lived through or your grandparents. I took a lot of cues from the civil rights movement. I did a lot of research on Brown versus Board of Education. And I see a lot of things repeating themselves in this country. A lot of fences and walls going up and people being afraid of one another. And that's what Undertow is about, and it's about a young woman who dares to care about somebody who isn't like her, and the dangers that that creates. And this is the first book. The second book is called Raging Sea. It comes out in February. And then there'll be a third book. I've also written another series called The Sisters Grimm. I don't know if anyone... Has anyone read The Sisters Grimm? Okay. You guys are really cool. I like that. Thank you. The idea for The Sisters Grimm also was one of these things that was just hanging from a tree. I read a book about the Brothers Grimm and discovered that they had a very creepy family and a very big family. There were a bunch of brothers and there were sisters, and I wondered what it must be like to have such weird brothers. And that's sort of where it came from. I always had a big imagination. I always loved stories. I know that I could tell you the story that a lot of writers tell you, where they were a small child and they went to the library and the librarian became their best friend. And I hear the story a lot. It just didn't happen for me. We actually didn't have a lot of books growing up in my house. My mother was a big fan of Irma Bombeck, so I know a lot about what it's like to be a suburban mom. But I don't know. We didn't have like the Time Machine or the Hobbit or anything in our house. So I made up my own stories, and that's sort of how it came. Some bell just rang. Is that the end? Okay. No? Okay. But, I do have ADD, and I do feel a little bit out of all over the place today. But the ADD has been sort of a gift, because it does keep my brain moving. And I know most people wouldn't call it a gift, but it's my brain's very agile, and I have ideas for things all the time. And if you have ADD, you should try to be a writer. I guess that's what I'm trying to tell you. I know I'm supposed to allot some time for some questions and some answers. So you guys give me the answers, and I will give you the questions. Anybody have any? Nothing. Okay, let's go. All right, Libba Bray, where is she?
I just wanted to point out that I like to call it value added, capital ADD.
Uh-huh. Oh, I love
it. I suffer from that as
That's
well.
That's awesome. Can I steal that? Okay, I am now value added. Do you hear that, honey? It's a plus. I'll read those text messages later, I promise. Yes, sir.
With your ADD, how do you discipline yourself to sit down and get the books done?
Oh, you know, that's a good question. You know, I recently was listening to a podcast, because I'm totally into that now. I get turned on to things 20 years after they become cool. And it was on a comedian named Sinbad. You remember that guy? He used to rule the world. And now we don't know where he is. But he's still a comedian. He's still doing it like every night. And he said that he has ADD, and he said that he had no problem concentrating on things. He just only concentrated on things he really liked. And all the other stuff he just blew off. And I guess I really like to write stories, so it's easy for me to manage that. But like the other things, like trying to pick up a loaf of bread on the way home, that sort of gets lost in the black hole. But the writing isn't really a big problem for me. In fact, my writing, where I write, people can't often believe it. I write in a Starbucks, which is like the loudest, most obnoxious place sometimes. And people are having, like, they're ending their marriages in there. And you know, they're like talking about terrible and personal things. But for some reason, that noise, I can't do it at home where it's quiet. It's very strange. Over here?
Yep. So how difficult or easy is it for you to write from a female perspective?
Oh, you know, I sometimes wonder if reincarnation is real. Because I tend to not really have too much of a problem writing from the female point of view. Now, when it came to this character is almost 17 in this book. And now I'm 46 and a dude. So there's a creepy thing that could happen. So what I did was, in this case, was I went to some female writer friends who write young adult fiction, and I can name a few of them. Jenny Hahn was one, Adele Griffin, Rebecca Searle, I stalked Libba Bray. The wonderful thing is that all these people live near me, and I asked them, you know, like, what do you want a male author to write from a 17-year-old girl's experience? And they had amazing answers, and I think that I did a good job trying to capture her inner heart, because I never was a 17-year-old girl and didn't really know a lot of 17-year-old girls when I was 17. Believe it or not, I just got cool recently, so. Yes, ma'am.
Are you going to continue the Sisters Grimm series?
I love that question. It's very sweet. It means a lot to me that you want more of it. I will tell you this. This year is actually the 10th anniversary of the series, and I am currently rewriting each book so that I spell everything right this time. And there is some talk of maybe doing a brand new Sisters Grimm story, but it wouldn't be about Sabrina and Daphne. It would be about Sabrina's daughters, Allison and Emma. So we'll see. You know, it's been very hard to turn my back on Fairyport Landing. When I left it, I thought, oh, I don't need this place. But you always want to go home, and I guess Fairyport Landing is where I live. So maybe send me a letter. Beg me. It helps if there's money in the envelope. Yes.
Okay, so first thing, I love all of your books. And
that's because you have excellent taste.
My second question is, what is your favorite book that you did not write?
Oh, what is my favorite book that I did not write? Well, I have to say, like, the book that made so much... actually sort of changed my life would be The Mouse and the Motorcycle by Beverly Cleary. Was because at the time, you know, like, you kids are lucky, I gotta tell you. When I was a kid, there was only like 5 kids' books, and 4 of them were about shooting your pet. So The Mouse and the Motorcycle was a revelation, and there's 3 reasons why I loved it. One, it's funny. It's a funny, funny book. 2, it's a big action adventure. Lots of crazy things happen in it. And 3, and this was the most important part of it for me when I was an 8-year-old boy, it's absolutely pointless. There wasn't any heavy-handed moral lesson I was supposed to learn. I wasn't going to become a better person reading The Mouse and the Motorcycle, but it is a joy, and I still read it. In fact, I read it to my son recently at bedtime, and he and I laughed through it just like I did when I was little. So that's, for me, the best book I've read that I wish I had written. But, you know, maybe if I build a time machine, I don't know, I can... Yes, miss.
Your books are so different that it's kind of hard to believe that you made up those ideas when they're so different. Like,
well,
how do you
them.
Do that? Like, because they're...
Where does it all come from?
Yeah.
Like... You know, recently I was having this conversation just last night with a friend of mine named Dan Santat, name drop. And I was talking about how, you know, the challenges of a career like mine, because I don't want to keep writing the same thing over and over and over. And I think that my life would be a lot easier if I could find just that thing I do that people get used to and they can expect it. I think I'd probably sell a lot more books, but I think I'd probably be bored to tears. I love Stephen King, but I wonder if he sits, you know, on his toilet sometimes and wonders if he could write a love story. You know, like, if anybody would buy and read that. And because I would like to read Stephen King's love story. But really, a lot, I would. So I don't know where the ideas come from. They just come, and then the ones that are the loudest in my head are the ones that get written. Someday I might try to figure out how this industry works so I can actually put my kid through private school. But until then, I'm going to just be writing whatever I'm excited about. Yeah.
Did you have the most fun, like, reinventing and, like, bringing back to life in your own fun way? Like, because they were so funny.
Thanks. I would say the most fun reinvented character I did was Prince Charming, who I didn't actually expect to use more than once. I thought I'd only write about him one time. And then he just was so interesting to me the way he came out. Because I don't really have a say in that, to be honest. I know, like, some people like to say they craft their characters, but they're full of baloney. That's not how it works. They just come out of your head, and they are who they are. But I liked him because he was born to be a hero. He was raised to be a hero. And then he's in love with someone who doesn't need a hero. Like, Snow White has finally figured out how not to be a victim, and she's proud of it. She's an awesome feminist superhero now. And how does a guy whose job it is to swoop in and carry the damsel off before the bad guys hurt her, how does a guy love somebody like that who doesn't even appreciate it? So I loved the struggle of Prince Charming realizing the woman he loves, the reason he loves her is because he doesn't have to rescue her. So I think that's probably my favorite character. God, that was really, really good. I should have written that down. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Two questions or so, but I'll be quick. Your book that is trying to help the immigrants,
mm-hmm.
like, do you think that that will have a deep effect on us welcoming people better and them welcoming us in a sense? Like, are you going to translate into Spanish too, and so it's more?
Well, I know it's in French. We're not really having a problem with the French.
Okay.
I would love for it to be in Spanish, and I know, like, Sisters Grimm is in, like, 22 languages, but we're just starting up with this. That would be an amazing thing. I don't know if the book will actually have an impact, but I do believe that, you know, if you want your kids to have, like, if you want the future to be awesome, you have to start with the children, and you have to teach them right and wrong early on so they don't keep making the mistakes the rest of us make. So hopefully, like, by writing for kids, I can inject a little bit of a world that would be better.
And the second question is about your upcoming books.
Mm-hmm.
Are any of the, like, the best parts of them going to be taken out and be made into a movie even before the book comes out? All right, thanks.
Oh,
nice day.
You're aware of that as well. Yeah, I'm sure there will be a series on television called Alphas or something soon. There are a couple TV shows on television that borrow from me liberally, which people say, you know, like, when you rip something off, that's the best compliment. I think the best compliment is a check. But the people at Grimm and Once Upon a Time don't agree. So I guess I could say I'm flattered that I'm a little bit ahead of the curve on some of this stuff, so that people are stealing from me and I'm not stealing from them. But it is infuriating, and I am in therapy. So. Yeah.
I really think you should continue the Sisters Grimm story.
So do my editors.
Yeah. Since that would be. I love the Sisters Grimm, and it's what brought me and my best friend together, so that would be awesome.
Oh, everybody, that's amazing.
And also, what is your favorite Sisters Grimm book out of the whole?
Well, I gotta go with book 5, which is called Magic and Other Misdemeanors. It's the time travel one. My favorite movie of all time is Back to the Future, and I have, yes, I have seen it 8,000 times, and I just forced my son to watch it, too. And I always wanted to write a time travel story, and it was fun getting to see what Sabrina and Daphne might turn out to look like. So that was my favorite. one to write, I think. Yeah. Yes.
How do you feel that you see that all these people love your books? How do you feel about that?
pretty good. All right, Doctor Who, I love this.
Aw, thank you. So I've got two questions, sort of, I don't know. Okay. First, so I'm a writer too, and I like evilly going into my stories and being like, okay, this nice person is gonna turn out to be the one killing all these people. Mm-hmm. And so I know you did that. You made me throw things with that twist. I'm not gonna spoil it.
Don't spoil it, okay.
So yeah. So, how do you decide who's gonna betray everybody, or do you just sit and write and then all of a sudden you decide, oh, this guy's gonna?
I just write every ex-girlfriend I ever had. No, yeah. Some of them were nice. In that specific one, it's hard to answer without spoiling it. But to me, there was something about that character that was unlike all the other characters, but it was easy to get you not to notice. Like, the character has two faces. It seemed like a big, oh, okay, yeah. And then there's, I don't know how it is. I mean, like, betrayal has to hurt, so it has to be somebody that they love. If it was like a bad guy or just some guy, you know, some drifter, it wouldn't be too exciting. But like, betrayal is painful and unexpected, and so I think that was easy for me. People ask me if I always knew if that was going to happen, and I did. I always knew who the bad guy was. I didn't always know how it was going to turn out, but I knew. Yeah. So.
Second question. So, have you ever thought of translating your books into Latin? Because I'm a complete nerd. I take Latin, and I like having all these books in Latin. So, have you ever considered that?
Yeah. I've never thought of that, no.
You should do that. Yes.
But now I will. I will. Okay. What happened to your arm?
I fell.
That's very vague.
Yes, it is.
You are not a writer. I need details.
I fell at Valley Forge by the Washington Chapel.
It's getting better. Is there a twist, like something? Did somebody push you? Was it?
No.
No, it was just a tumble?
Yeah.
And how many bones did you break?
Two.
See? Two bones, all right.
I have two questions, too.
For each bone.
What was your favorite nerds book?
Oh, I love, the one that was the hardest to write was the fourth one, where Flinch is the main character. Flinch is the one who also has ADD, and he's a little bit hyperactive, and the more sugar he eats, the stronger he gets. Flinch was always sort of like the comic element of the books, and then all of a sudden I had to write a whole book about him. So it was fun trying to figure out who he was. Yeah.
And also, how did you survive with only 5 books when you were a kid?
Well, like I said, I read a lot of my mom's stuff, a lot of romance novels, a lot of swarthy men with no shirts. That's what we had, you know? It's like, my dad really wasn't a reader. My mom loved those kind of novels. So, I just read cereal boxes and things like that mostly. But yeah, there really were only 5, like Old Yeller, Dead Dog. The Yearling, dead deer. Bambi, dead deer. Lots of the animals are the only tragedy a child could handle in the 70s. So, yeah.
Okay.
Okay, I think we have time for one more. Okay, Mr.
From start to finish, what is your writing process like?
Oh. Well, thanks, guys. Yeah. I'll try to do it as briefly as I can. It usually starts with an idea. I will write that idea down very briefly, and then I let what I call it percolate Like I let it steep in a way. And whenever an idea will come to me related to it, I will write that down until I have a very good sense of the character and maybe what's going to happen. But I will not start the book until I know how it ends. I don't do this sort of like improvisational writing where you just sit down and start writing a book. That's insane. I usually plot it out very briefly because I hate outlines, but I do need to know like major plot points along the way. And then I use it as sort of a roadmap to get from point A to point B. And then every day I write, Monday through Friday. I will try to pump out about 2,000 to 3,000 words a day if it's possible. And then I generally don't get writer's block. But when I do get stuck on something, I will go back to the first page and start rewriting and cleaning it up. So the first half of every book I've ever written is really good because I have rewritten that half about 70 zillion times. And then the last half of the book is when the editor called me and said I was a week late. So it's not as good. And then I try to fix, you know, it all together. I probably do a zillion rewrites, but that's just how my brain works. If I get stuck, it helps me unplug. So, folks, I am doing a signing today in the sub-basement by the boiler. It is at 3 o'clock? Okay, the audience knows, good. All right, 3 o'clock, and I will sign anything you want, books, body parts, posters, but I'm just so glad. I wanna thank you guys all for coming out. This is the best book festival in the country, at least of all the ones I've been to. And it's because of you guys, because you come out and support this. So thank you for having me, and I hope to see you downstairs.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.